हेलो स्टूडेंट्स, हाय वेलकम टू दिस पर्टिकुलर सेशन। लेट मी फर्स्ट कंफर्म विद ऑल ऑफ यू स्टूडेंट। आदित्य गुड इवनिंग। पवन कुमार, निशांक, वेरी गुड इवनिंग टू ऑल ऑफ यू। प्रियदर्शिनी, just follow the truth, quickly give the confirmation and then we can start. Priyanka, good evening. I'm good, Priyanka. Students, we will now look into the practical problems quickly. Trinath, Priya, good evening, good evening. We shall now look into the practical areas of the questions as well. Hopefully, you would have gone through those small sections as well as the disallowances part which are being there, because you will find the practical questions which has been put up by the ICAI. Ben, good evening. Which has been put up by the ICAI has to do with all these points that we are going to discuss it just now. So far as the small sections is concerned, students, if you see your module also, either you will either you will find this coverage of the small deductions, like 43b, student, there is one section 43b which talks about the deduction of certain specified expenditure, the deduction of certain specified expenditure only if that particular amount or the expenditure has been paid. So that is like 43B provision which is there. You will find that, students, that these sections essentially would be targeted only in the form of an adjustment, like some small adjustment, add and less kind of a thing that you have to do, because you have to disallow it, and if you have to disallow it, then you need to add it back, isn't it? So such small adjustment is what would be required in this particular context. Such particular small adjustment is what would be required in this particular context. So in that regard, students, in that regard, what we will deal with, what we are going to deal with, that would be I will, on the request of some of the students, will quickly go through quickly all these small sections once, because that is what many students have requested in the last lecture, and then we will quickly then get into some of the practical questions which are being there. So here in in the context of the small deduction, students, let's get started with this one. The first one, now you will take this particular slide, is slide number 12. Slide number 12. So herein, the first one, 3611B, premium paid by the employer for the health insurance of the employees. So therefore, the employer has made the payment, or like a group insurance policy, something of that sort has been taken, and therefore the employer has made the payment of the premium. So what is the treatment of that particular premium amount? So therefore, they have said that the treatment of this particular premium amount shall be the premium paid by the employer for the health insurance of the employee. This premium would be allowed as deduction. This premium would be allowed as deduction, but only condition is that this should not be paid. The mode of payment should be other than in cash. This is one thing that you should be careful about it. So if they say clearly that the premium which is paid by the employer on the group medical insurance policy of the employee and that premium is not paid in cash, then in that particular case, this amount will be allowed as deduction. 3612, which is about the bonus and commission paid by the employer to the employee. Now in this regard, students, just you can do this and rest of it, you can just skip it. Herein, rest of it when I say up till here. This case law, or I can just put it across it. So herein, the point which I have earmarked, you can just delete the same. The point which I have just earmarked, you can just simply delete the same. Where the bonus due to the employee is paid to the trust, such amount is subsequently paid to the employee, all that, up till the due date. Up till what? The due date, you can just delete the same. You can delete the same, students. Okay. Now this part, students, is very important. One particular aspect which has been there. In this situation, subject to the provision of section 43B, meaning thereby whenever 43B comes into play, whenever 43B will come into play, what is that understanding that you will have? That the deduction of this amount would be allowed only when the actual payment has been done. So if the actual payment has been done, that the deduction of these amount would be allowed to the SSE. So these are all subject to the actual payment, students. So therefore, just be very careful about the same. Whenever 43B reference would be given. However, in the very first year, students, you have the grace period also. That is, you can make the payment of these specified item. You can make the payment of these specified item up to the due date of filing of the return of income. Up to the due date of filing of the return of income. And that is section 139.1. So if supposingly, if this bonus and commission is pertaining to the previous year 1920, and if I make the payment on or before the due date of filing of the ROI, which in your case happens to be 30th of November 2020, then in that case, I will be allowed the deduction of this bonus and commission in this previous year 1920 itself. Because I have made the payment of the bonus on or before the due date of filing of the ROI. There can be one more angle, students, in the examination that they can give it to you on bonus and commission. One more angle can be there. You will say, sir, what is that angle? So that is about the case where, the bonus which has been given, the bonus and commission is say for a previous year 1819. And that bonus and commission of previous year 1819 has been paid on 1st of December 2019. That bonus and commission of previous year 1819 has been paid. When it has been paid? On 1st of December 2019. And if that is the case, we will say what? That for previous year 1819, this bonus and commission shall not be allowed as deduction. For previous year 1819, this bonus and commission shall not be allowed as deduction, and it will be allowed as deduction only in the previous year 1920. Then this bonus and commission will be allowed as deduction only in the previous year 1920, students. And that is how you are supposed to look upon in this regard. So students, if you see over here, so subject to the provision of section 43B, deduction allowable only on actual payment on or before the due date of furnishing of the ROI under section 139.1, irrespective of the previous year in which the liability to pay arises. And 48.2 angle, students, is also given it to you. 48.2 angle, students. Now there is one more disallowance, section 48.2, students. Do you know what is 48.2? What is this 48.2? Just let me know quickly. Let me see how many of you can answer this. What is this 48.2? Quickly. Fair enough, students. 42. So 48.2 students is in respect of expenditure that you have made to a related party. Yes, Pawan. Pramnath, yes, it is. Expenditure which you have made to a related party. In that particular case, whatever is the excess of the expenditure. So if you are doing a transaction, say with your related party, and therefore say my relative, my own relative with whom I am doing the transaction, and I am purchasing the goods from him, then I may try to convey to him that, look, I want to reduce my profit for the current year, so kindly do one thing, give me an over invoicing in that transaction, because whatever is of 10,000, I will pay you 15,000 and give me the bill of 15,000. And in any case, the money is coming to our home itself, because you are a relative. So therefore, through this over invoicing route, I am incurring an expenditure which is in excess of the fair market value of that transaction, and therefore whatever is the excess of the amount, that much portion of the excess students will be disallowed under section 48.2. That much portion of the excess will be disallowed under section 48.2. This is what this 48.2 says. So 48.2, excessive or unreasonable part of the expenditure is disallowed. That is how it has to be considered in this regard. Okay, so therefore, if a bonus and commission, if I'm paying to my relative, I'm an employer, and I'm paying to my relative bonus and commission in excess of an amount or in about the fair market value, then whatever is the excess amount that I have debited, students, that excess amount will be disallowed. Now, students, coming to this particular part in this context. The next one, students, if you see 3614, 3615 and 3615A, all these sections taken together. Now, what happens in these sections? Students, these are the case of the employer. ER is the employer. Here, if you can see over here. Okay, so employer contribution towards these approved or the superannuation fund. These are all the approved fund where the employer is making the contribution. Employer contribution in these particular approved fund. Okay. 3615 is about the employer's contribution again to the approved gratuity fund. Approved. Fine. 3615A, the next one, students, is about the employee contribution. Now, how the employee makes a contribution? We all know these fund which are meant for the employee benefit. With these funds which are meant for the employee benefit, a portion of the amount is contributed by the employer. A portion of the amount is contributed by the employee. That is to say, from the employee's contribution, the amount is reduced. From the employee's contribution, the amount is reduced from their salary. From their salary, it has been deducted. And that is the portion of the employee's contribution along with my contribution I am going to put up. Where am I going to put up this particular amount? So, students, I am going to put up this particular amount in these respective fund. Now, the question is, students, be careful. As far as my contribution is concerned, I am the employer. As far as my contribution is concerned, this is an expenditure. Why it's an expenditure? It is going from my pocket. It is an expenditure which is going from my pocket. So, what the law says? The law says this, that for the employer contribution for which you are looking at to section 3614 or section 3615, that is the employer contribution to the recognized provident fund or the superannuation fund or the approved gratuity fund, for that employer contribution you can make the deposit on or before the due date of filing of the ROI. Same thing that you have learned for the bonus and commission, is also extended to the employer's contribution. That is extended to the employer's contribution, students, and It will be allowed as deduction if the contribution is made on or before the due date of filing of the ROI under section 139.1. Employer contribution. So same example which I have given it to you for bonus and commission, that your due date for previous year 1920, the due date to file the ROI will come by 30th November 2020. If I the employer makes their contribution, my own contribution, before the due date of filing of the ROI, then in that particular case, I will be allowed the deduction on the same previous year, 1920, in computing my PGBP. But the twist in this case, students, is that of the employee contribution. The twist in this case, students, is that of the employee contribution. You will say, sir, what kind of twist there is? So, students, a twist, as I told you, is in respect of the employer contribution. In the employer contribution, students, what happens? The employer, from the salary of the employee, they deduct the employee contribution. The employer, from the salary of the employee, they deduct the employer contribution, employee's contribution. So please understand one thing. The employee contribution is not, the employee contribution is not an expenditure of the employer. Do you all agree? Because from your salary only, I am deducting your contribution. Fine. So the law says, be careful. The law says this, that the moment the employer deducts from the employee contribution, deduct from the salary of the employees, their contribution, employee's contribution, then it will be considered as the income of the employer. So it will be considered as what? As the income of the employer. So it will be add income. Why it is an income? Because I have deducted from the salary of the employee's employee contribution. So I'm going to add as it, this is my income. And then I, the employer, will be allowed a deduction of that amount which I have already have considered as the income. I, the employer, will be allowed the deduction of that amount which I have already considered this as an income, only if I make the payment of that amount on or before the due date of filing of the ROI. Sorry, on or before the due date of the fund itself. Do you know, students, as such you are not supposed to know, but for your knowledge purpose itself, I'm just letting you know. The due date of these funds, students, be careful, the due date of these funds comes in the next month itself. To make the deposit, the due date happens in the next month itself. Every month, next month itself, this will be the due date. So employer who has deducted from the employee salary, employee's contribution, who has deducted from the employee salary, the employee contribution, this employer will be allowed the deduction. This employer will be allowed the deduction only when I have made the deposit of the employee contribution before the due date of the fund, not the due date of the ROI. For my contribution, I can deposit up to the due date of the ROI. For my contribution, I can deposit the money up to the due date of the ROI. But for the employee contribution, which is already considered as my income, for the employee contribution which I have deducted from their salary and which is already considered as my income, if I want to claim a deduction, then I need to make a deposit. I need to make a deposit on or before the due date of that fund itself, or else it will not be considered for the purpose of deduction at all. It will not be considered for the purpose of deduction at all. So, if I have to say, students, to you, just last point, pay attention. If I have to say to all of you is this, that employee contribution, supposedly I make the payment after the due date of the fund. Okay, will I still be eligible to claim a deduction in respect of the employee contribution? If the employee contribution, I make the payment on or after the due date of the fund, will I be still be eligible to claim the deduction in respect of the employee contribution? And the answer is no. Whereas, as far as the employer contribution is concerned, if I make the deposit of that employer contribution, my own contribution, and I make the deposit even after the due date of the fund, still I will be allowed the deduction of this particular employer contribution. Even though I make the deposit after the due date of the fund, still for my contribution I will given the deduction. So this is one point that you should be very, very careful about it, students, so far as your examination is concerned. So in this regard, students, in this context, if you see over here carefully, see the employee contribution. This is your employee contribution, students. This is your employee contribution. This is your employee contribution. So what it says, contribution received by SSC from his employees to the fund, from his employees to the fund. Okay, so the first effect would be, it is a first effect of such amount, it is an income, income of the employer. Whose income? Income of the employer. Second effect, deduction allowed. Okay, now in this regard, such amount is credited by employer to the employee's account in the relevant fund on or before the due date of the ROI. In this case, herein, will be allowed as deduction. I am just putting it like this. Will be allowed as deduction is the question to be asked. Will be allowed as deduction is the question to be asked. And to that the answer is no. The Gujarat High Court. Now this case law name, friends, at least in your IPCC level, you are not supposed to remember the case law name. So I'm just deleting it so as to avoid any confusion. The High Court has held that if the employer fails to make the payment of the employee's contribution, employer fails to make the payment of the employee's contribution on or before the due date of the fund, then the deduction under section 3615A shall not be allowed thereafter. Thereafter, he will not be allowed the deduction. Did you all got this one, students? So just keep this particular point in mind. For your contribution, employer contribution, you don't have to worry. Why you don't have to worry? Because, can you see over here, for the employer contribution, students, be careful you in this regard. For the employer contribution, you have that magical 43B. For the employer contribution, you have the 43B as the provision, but for the employee contribution, so if you see over here, students, within the due date of 139(1), this is for whose contribution? 3614 and 3615 is for whose contribution? This is for students. This is for the employer contribution. This is for the employer contribution. So that things which is there in the highlight 43B within the due date of 139(1). So this is meant for the employer contribution. Now 40A7, again one more disallowed, students. 40A7 says that no deduction for any provision made by the SSC for the payment of the gratuity. So provision for gratuity, students, provision of gratuity to his employees, will you get deduction? And the answer is no. Why you will not get deduction? Because 43B is given to you, and what 43B says, deduction allowed only on the actual payment. And if the item is covered under 43B, if the item is covered under 43B, then the deduction in respect of that payment, then the deduction in respect of that payment will only be allowed under payment basis. Only will be allowed on payment basis. And that exactly one point that you all need to take into account, students. That is one point that you all need to take into account. Fine, herein. Now with that particular proposition, students, herein, let's come to, like, quickly, in this context, 3619, the family planning expenditure, students, family planning expenditure. Now if you see over here, the family planning expenditure, the company allowed only to a company, can you see herein, the company only is the one which will be eligible to claim the deduction. Now if the expenditure is revenue nature, if the expenditure is revenue nature, then in that case full amount will be allowed as deduction. Then in that case, full amount will be allowed as deduction. Whereas if the expenditure is capital in nature, then 1/5 would be allowed as deduction, and that would be allowed for a period of 5 years. 1/5 will be allowed as deduction, and that will be allowed as deduction for a period of 5 years. So that is one thing that has been to be considered. Okay, so that one point, students, just you will keep in mind, allowed first of all only to the company, not to any other person. And revenue expenditure 100%, capital expenditure only 1/5. Now coming to the next one point, students, 3613 herein. Now this particular expenditure, students, is interest paid in respect of the capital borrowed. So whatever is the interest expenditure which I have paying for the capital which I have borrowed, will the interest expenditure be allowed to me as a deduction? And the answer is yes. Provided what? Provided the loan which I have taken, the capital which I have borrowed, that is being used for the purpose of business. So if it is used for the purpose of my business, then the interest expenditure on such loan amount or the interest expenditure on the capital borrowed, that interest expenditure will be allowed to me as a deduction. That interest expenditure will be allowed to me as a deduction. That is point number one. Now, point number two, students, in this regard, point number two, students, be careful, is one proviso which is there to section 3613. Just you will remember this point, students, very carefully. This is an important one. This proviso to section 3613. Now, what does this proviso say, students? Just all of you will put pay attention to this one very, very carefully. As per this proviso, students, if I am taking a loan to acquire the asset, if I am taking the loan to acquire the asset, then in that case, can I say that the loan has been applied for the purpose of business and profession? If I have taken the loan for the purpose of acquiring the asset, can I therefore say that the loan has been applied for the purpose of business and profession? Yes, very much I can say that the loan has been acquired for the purpose of business and profession. The loan has been acquired for the purpose of business and profession. It definitely can be said that the loan has been acquired for the purpose of business and profession. But interest expenditure on such loan amount, students, be careful, pay attention now. The interest expenditure on such loan amount up to the date the asset is put to use, up to the date the asset is put to use, that interest expenditure has to be capitalized. That interest expenditure will be done what? Will be capitalized. So the interest expenditure up to the date the asset is put to use, that will be capitalized. Be careful. And only after the asset is put to use, any interest expenditure which is incurred after that asset is put to use, that the interest expenditure will be allowed as deduction. This is what this particular point means. So what it says, from the date of capital borrowed till the date the asset is first put to use, from the date the asset is borrowed till the date the asset is first put to use, what you are going to do in that case? Capitalized with the cost of the asset. Capitalized with the cost of the asset. And what about this one? Allowed as deduction after the asset is first put to use. After the asset is first put to use, that once the asset is put to use, the interest expenditure incurred thereafter, the interest expenditure incurred thereafter will be allowed as deduction. But be careful. But be careful. This is subject to. Subject to what? Subject to. Don't forget your favorite section 43B. So sir, here also 43B exists? Yes. On my right hand side, the condition part, I have already made a mention. 43B, students, in respect of interest on loan will be applicable. That is to say, the deduction for interest on loan will be allowed if the loan has been taken, where the loan has been taken from bank or financial institution. In such particular case, the interest on such loan will be allowed to you as a deduction only when you make the payment. And as I told you earlier also, if your expenditure is covered under section 43B, be careful and please take this always in your mind. If my expenditure is covered in section 43B, then in that case, I have the grace period to make the payment. I have the grace period to make the payment up to the due date of the filing of the return of income. So if I make the payment for 1920, if I make the payment on or before the due date of filing of the return of income, then those expenditure on which 43B is applicable, which includes also interest on loan amount taken from whom? The loan taken from the bank or the public financial institution. So all these expenditure will be allowed to you as a deduction in the same year. But you say, no sir, I have made the payment thereafter. Thereafter means after the due date of filing of the return of income. Then in that situation, the deduction of that expenditure will be allowed to you as a deduction in the previous year. In which previous year? In the previous year in which the amount has been paid. In the previous year, the amount has been paid. In the previous year, the amount has been paid. Okay. So this is what the situation is in this regard. So if you see over here very carefully in this context, thirty-six, one, three A students. This is a discount on. This is on what? Discount on the zero coupon bond. The discount on the zero coupon bond. So pro rata basis, the computation has been made. So the pro rata, the computation has been made. So when you talk about this one. When you talk about this particular part, one, pro rata computation, herein, discount is equal to, if you see, maturity value of the bond minus what the issue price of the bond. So students, you will find these small things coming in your small questions and all. I'll show you where the ICAI has picked up all these small questions, questions which are based on these small sections. So it is like what discount, like. Just simple logic, students. Debentures I am issuing. Okay. Issued at 80, redeemed at 100. Issued at 80, redeemed at 100. So the difference of 20, that difference of 20 will be allowed as deduction on a pro rata basis. That deduction of 20 will be allowed to you on a pro rata basis. So that is how it has to be considered. So on a pro rata basis, that the deduction will be allowed. Fine, students. In this case. So students, if you see 3617 now, 3617, bad debts, students, bad debts, this is an important section, mark this to be an important one, students, very important section for bad debts, please read this one quickly, all of you, 2 minutes time. You will read this particular part only, and then this part. So what I am marking it, just stick with that. All of you through with this? Ashwini is asking, sir, is it that till put to use, no depreciation, no interest allowed, and after put to use, both are allowed? See, Ashwini, the asset has to be put to use, only then the depreciation will begin. Okay, and till that time, whatever is the interest expenditure that you have incurred, till that time, whatever is the interest expenditure that you have incurred, that will be capitalized. That will be capitalized. Okay, till the time the asset is put to use, whatever interest expenditure that you have incurred, that will be capitalized. And after that, after what? After the asset is put to use, after the asset is put to use, that whatever interest expenditure is incurred will be allowed to you as a deduction. Will be allowed to you as a deduction. Now, after this one, students, 41 subsection 4, herein. Now, let us look upon to the deduction of the bad debts. Now, in the context of the bad debts as a deduction, students, please pay attention. The deduction of bad debts would be allowed if you satisfy both the condition. And what is that both the condition? Number one, like simple, visualize, students, there is a credit sales. There is what? A credit sales. And because of that credit sales, there is a debtor position that would have been generated. Because of that credit sales, so it is like what? Debtor's account debit to sales account. Debtor's account debit to sales account. So that is what will be the position that will be determined. Thereafter, the debtors would be on the balance sheet side. Debtor would be on the balance sheet side. Fine. Now, the debtors being on the balance sheet side, you are going to write it off the debtors account in your books. You are going to write it off the debtors accounts in your books of accounts. And therefore, that write off of the debtors in your books of accounts will give you the deduction of bad debts. So, there are two conditions, students. Repeat with me. Two conditions are there if you want to claim the deduction of bad debts. Condition number one, there the amount which you are writing off subsequently as bad debts. The amount which you are subsequently writing off as bad debts, this amount should have been considered as your income earlier. And that is the reason why I gave you the general entry. What is the general entry? The debtors account debit to sales. Where the sales goes? P&L credit side. So did you offer that amount as your income earlier? Yes, you have offered that amount as your income earlier. Thereafter, subsequently, what you are supposed to do, whatever is the debtors account in your balance sheet, whatever is the debtors amount in your balance sheet, you will write it off in your books of accounts as the bad debts. You will write it off in your books of accounts as the bad debts. And that is what will be the reduction of the bad debts that will be allowed. After that, in this regard, if you see over here very, very carefully, 41 subsection 4, this is what, students, deemed income. Deemed income, students, is this, that subsequently, if I have claimed the deduction of bad debts by writing off the debtors in my books of accounts, I have already have claimed the deduction of bad debts, isn't it? So if subsequently the I have done the recovery of bad debts, I have done what? The recovery of bad debts. So whether that recovery of bad debts, will it be considered as your income? Whether the recovery of the bad debts which you have done, will that recovery of bad debts, will that be considered as your income? And the answer is yes. Why? Because I gave you the deduction earlier, but that deduction is a false deduction. Why that deduction is a false deduction? Because subsequently you have recovered the amount, and therefore on the subsequent recovery, that amount will be considered as a deemed income. That amount, students, will be considered as what? As a deemed income. Did you all got this one? So that is one point which you should be careful about it, students. That should be one point that you should be careful about it. Okay, so that is one thing that you should be very careful about it in this regard. So students, this is one thing which is to be considered thereafter. Thereafter what? 36.113, 36.118. Now students, banking cash transaction tax, security transaction tax, commodity transaction tax is allowed as deduction by virtue of these sections. Section number 36 only. Remember only, students, section 36. No need further of the clause number. And finally, students, finally what? Finally, the general deduction. The general deduction, students. And what is the general deduction? 37.1. See, let's read this one general deduction together. General or allowable deduction under PGBP, expenditure point number A, not covered under 32-36. Point number B, not being personal in nature. Point number C, not being capital in nature. Point number D, not being prohibited by law or an offense. And point number E, wholly and exclusively incurred for the purpose of business and profession. So if there is 32-36 covers all the specific expenditure. 32-36 students. What about 30 and 31, by the way? Let me ask you, students, what is this section 30 and 31? What is this section 30 and 31. Pramath, Nishank, Pavan Kumar, Priya. Indeed, the students are saying correct answer. So, I think they have already have done it. So, very good. Good to know about that. Rent, rate, repair, insurance, taxes, municipal tax, which is paid in respect of, if it is paid, these rent, rate, repairs, insurance, if it is paid in respect of building, it is section 30. If it is paid in respect of building, it is section 30. If it is paid in respect of plant and machinery and furniture, then it is section 31. Plant and machinery and furniture, then students, it is section 31. Then it is section 31. So these are the two sections, 30 and 31. That is what you will always keep in mind, students. Fine. Now on that note, if you see very carefully, on that note, if you see all very carefully, that 30 and 31 is over there. Plus 32 we have already have done. What is 32? 32, your favorite section, depreciation. After that, selective sections, whatever are there, the big deduction. These big deductions were there in 35. Namely, 35 AD, specified business. 35 scientific research. Scientific research has two parts. Thereafter 35 triple C, 35 CCD, that skill development, agricultural project. These are the big deductions. And after that 36, what we have done today. So these are the, if the expenditure is covered in the specific provision, then the specific provision will apply. But if it is not covered in the specific provision, if it is not covered in the specific provision, then students, game on. You are in section 37. You will then be under section 37. And in section 37, you will find point number A, not covered under 32-36. Point number B, not being personal in nature. Point number C, not being capital in nature. Not being prohibited by law. Or it is an offense like penalty levied in a law. In a law, penalty has been levied on you. Which law? Say GST law. Penalty has been levied on you. Disallowed, students. Disallowed. Why? It is prohibited by law. Isn't it? And point number E is what? That expenditure should be wholly and exclusively incurred for the purpose of business and profession. So that expenditure should be wholly and exclusively be incurred for the purpose of business and profession. Only then the deduction will be allowed. Only then the deduction will be allowed. So this is precisely what is the way in which a deduction will be taken into account. Now, students, if you see herein, I am going to take my CSR expenditure, students. Any CSR expenditure, please note on one thing. You will be given in the examination. Points like CSR expenditure, I think all of you are aware, this is corporate social responsibility expenditure. If that CSR expenditure is given to you in any form, like a donation, setting off of the school or setting up of the hospital, whatever is the CSR expenditure is incurred, not allowed as deduction, students. Okay, similarly, a company giving freebies, like free medicine to the doctors and all the freebies, not a knowledge reduction. Now, apart from that, what did tick mark show? Just focus on the tick mark part. Point number five, which is about fines and penalty, I was just discussing with you right now. Under a statutory scheme, what do you mean by statutory scheme? Meaning under a law. Which, can you give me the, I have given you the example. Under the law, I have given you the example of that. Like GST. Example is say GST. And in that, there is a fine and penalty. And a deduction will be allowed? No. These fine and penalty will not be allowed as deduction. But if the penalty is out of a contract between you and me, student, between you and me, we are having a contract. And in that contractual scheme that the penalty is being imposed, in that contractual scheme that the penalty is being imposed, then whether the deduction will it be allowed? And the answer is yes, incurred for the purpose of incurred in the course of the business and profession. So this will become yes, students, in this regard. So out of a contractual liability, the answer would be yes. If you see the next one, for an activity considered as an offense, for an activity which is considered as an offense or which is prohibited by law, we have already have discussed that. What it will be? No, isn't it? But interest expenditure, students, what is disallowed is what is prohibited, like penalties and all, because you have broken the law and therefore I'm putting a penalty on you. But interest is a delay in the payment. Payment of what? Payment of say GST. Then it is not a fine or nor it is a penalty. It is not a payment that you are doing in consequence of breaking a law. There is a delay, but you have not broken the law. It's not crime, isn't it? And therefore, students, for the interest, will you be allowed as deduction? And the answer is yes. So that is one thing that you should, students, keep in mind in this context. And I think that tick mark and point number seven, students, also. There are a lot of advertisement that you do in the newspaper of the political party, isn't it? Advertisement, students, that you do in the newspaper of the political party. You may be aware of that. There are many of the newspapers which are being put across in the political party. So therefore, the company or the SSC who is doing their advertisement in the newspaper, it is actually a donation that you are giving to the political party. And therefore, under the head PGVP, this donation is disallowed. So will it be allowed as reduction? No. Because it is equivalent to donation given to the political party. So therefore, no deduction would be allowed. However, students, here, there are these two sections. Chapter 6A, students, in Chapter 6A, these deduction will be allowed to you. In Chapter 6A, these deduction will be allowed to you. And that exactly how it has to be considered. Did you all got this one? Fine, students. And that is how the things has to be looked upon very, very carefully. Now, with that, students, we are done with this. Now, this is not required, students. This is also not required. So, please delete this particular part. 3617A. Please delete this particular part also. 3617A. Okay. 3617A. 3535AD. We have already touched upon this. AMT also we have done in the last lecture. So this is the ATJJE is there, students, but I'll do it a bit later, not now. Chapter 6 reduction is there. Now 40A2 and 40A3. Now, students, I will do a selective scheme. Now please read 40A3 now, all of you. 40A3, and in this 40A3, from here till the last, Rule 6DD exception. 2 minutes time, friends. Quickly, 2 minutes time. Yes, DSB. Bribe, protection money, all are disallowed. Bribe and protection money. 2 minutes time, friends. 40A3. Last time you are doing it right now, and thereafter you will do it only in the examination time. Quickly. Priyanka, if you are through with it soon, just let me know quickly. So here, students, first of all, understand one thing here. One is about 48.3, which is about the expenditure which you have incurred. Obviously, cash expenditure, we have been talking about it. There are two limits, students. One is the 10,000 limit. One is the 10,000 limit. And another is the limit of 35,000. Be careful on that. One is the 10,000 limit. And another is the limit of 35,000. Now, what is this 35,000 limit? First, try to understand. If Reliance Industry, for their transporters, who are transporting their goods from the factory to the customer premises, if they are giving the amount in cash, to these transporters who are transporting the goods to the different premises, then in that particular case, students, what we will say? We'll say that the threshold level will not be then 10,000 to see whether it is allowed or disallowed. Then threshold level will increase to 35,000. And only then, if the amount exceed beyond 35,000, then in that scenario, the disallowance would be applicable. So when you make the payment to GTA, to your GTA for transportation of the goods, so in that context, the threshold of 10,000 will be substituted to threshold of 35,000. Now, there is one section 40A3 and below that 40A3A. You will say, sir, what is the difference between the two? The difference is very simple, students. If, say, previous year is 1920, if in the same previous year 1920, I have incurred an expenditure of, say, rupees 15,000, and on the single day, in previous year 1920 itself, aggregate of my all payments, otherwise than by way of an account pay check or by way of an account pay draft or through other prescribed electronic means, if my single day aggregate payment has exceeded by more than rupees 10,000, then the expenditure which I want to allow in 1920, the expenditure which I want to claim as deduction in 1920, that expenditure will get disallowed. The expenditure which I want to claim in the year 1920, that expenditure will get disallowed. But you will say, sir, but if supposingly in 1920 there is no default, like the expenditure you have claimed in 1920, but the payment has been made next year, the payment has been made, then what will you do? Will you disallow in 1920? No, then you don't disallow in 1920, students. If the next year the payment is made, then in the next year it will be. So what will happen? In 1920, there will not be any disallowance. But in 2021, in my example, it was next year. You can say also, sir, 4 years afterwards, I am making the payment. Whenever you make the payment now. You have not made the payment in 1920? No, you have not made the payment in 1920. So, wherever you make the payment now, in that very year, it will be considered as deemed income. That is what 40A3A, is all about. So, if it is in the same year, then 40A3. If it is in the subsequent period, any year, then no disallowance, then no disallowance in the year in which the expenditure is incurred. But in the subsequent year, or the year in which the payment is made, in that very year, the deemed income will be considered, or deemed income will be determined. Students, this rule 6DD is very important for your IPCC, And we all know what this rule 6DD is all about. Now, rule 6DD is about what, students? Exception where you can continue to make the payment in cash. Continue to make the payment in cash in excess of 10,000 or in excess of rupees 35,000 without any disallowances. Without any disallowances. You'll say, sir, what are those cases? So those cases are in front of you. Those cases are in front of you. Now, in that regard, students, in this regard, if you see very carefully, 35,000, which has been there. 35,000, sorry, just read this one, students, quickly. I think payment to the government, say GST, example, GST paid to the government. GST paid to the government in cash. GST paid to the government in cash. So will that be allowed as deduction? And the answer is yes. Thereafter, if you see, bank is closed. And because the bank is closed, that the payment has to be made, will it be allowed as deduction? Again, the answer is yes. Payments are made to the agent. Students, payments are to be made to the agent. Herein. Forget payment to the agent. Just tick mark whatever I am just doing. Payment to the government. Bank is closed. Bank is closed. What is the reason why the bank is closed? Public holiday or strike. Students, bank is closed. What is the reason for the bank is closed? Public holiday or because of strike. That is important. Payment to cottage industry, students, tick mark this. Then, like this e-payment, a debit card and all, you can just tick mark this also. Payment to the cultivator or the grower or producer of agricultural production. Payment of agricultural produce, please write. Payment to the cultivator or grower or producer of the agricultural produce. So directly to the agriculturalist. Directly to the agriculturalist you are making the payment. If directly to the agriculturalist you are making the payment, will that be allowed as deduction? And the answer is yes, it will be allowed as deduction, even though the payment is not made. So this is a tick mark, students, which I have done. And no bank service available in that place. No bank services is available in that place. That is what, students, you should always keep in mind. Like now, I don't know whether any, even today, village are having a bank. At least they have got the cooperative bank. So I don't know whether we have found any place where we can say that it is not served by any bank. I haven't came across with any such thing. I don't know if these things exist or not. Be that as it may, we don't worry about these things now. Coming back, students, herein. All of you will pay attention to this one. Students. Now, 40A7, students, I have just now done. Provision for gratuity. Is it disallowed? Yes, it is disallowed. 40A9 also I have done. Like, if you see, what is allowed as deduction is approved. Employer's contribution, students, employer's contribution to the approved funds or to the recognized funds, recognized employee funds. That is what is allowed as deduction. Employer's contribution to the approved or the recognized funds, that is what is allowed as deduction. So if I'm making the payment for the unapproved or unorganized funds, will that be allowed as deduction? Will that be allowed as deduction? And the answer is no. If I'm making the payment to these unapproved or unorganized funds, will that be allowed as deduction? To that, the answer is, students, no, it will not be allowed as deduction. Okay, so any unapproved fund, employee funds, which I am as an employer making the contribution, I will not be allowed any deduction whatsoever. Did you got this one, students? Now, 40AI and 40AIA, I'm not going to touch upon right now. 40AI, this I want you to go through it once. 40AI, 40AIA. Can you see these things? These things, I want you to go through it quickly. Not today, as your homework. I will be touching upon these things tomorrow. I'm just quickly going through to 43B, students. 43B. please come to 43B, the last one. Didn't I told you about 43B, students here? certain deductions to be allowed only on actual payment on or before the due date specified under section 139(1). This particular part. So students, herein. Now students, one suggestion before we can proceed further, which I have got from the students. They say that, sir, we have to also study at our end. So why don't you in fact take across our last moment? Like last moment is, they have told me that 9 o'clock. You start at 9 o'clock so that we can, throughout the day, we will study our stuff. And 9 o'clock, sir, we will do a revision of that income tax with you. So that is the proposal. So 9 to 10:30 or 10:45 is what students have, some students have said to me. Is that okay if we do it? If, because obviously your studies are also equally important. So this proposal that some students have given me, that sir, throughout the day we will study and maybe do at a dinner time when we are having our dinner. At that time we will watch it so that our time is also saved in this process. That is a suggestion which some students have given me, that during the dinner time we are listening and we are participating so that our time is also saved in that way, and we are also equally are revising also, and also we, our time is saved. So what is your take, students? 9 o'clock is some suggestion which I have got it, and I thought that maybe let me convey to the students. So in that very case, if every one of you are all okay with it, then we can then consider 9. For me it is okay. For me it is not an issue at all. But at your side, quickly let me know, students. nine pm to 10:30 10:45. So after that you can sleep and get up early in the morning and then start studying. Use your full day of your study. Use full day of your study. And thereafter you can take it forward. WhatsApp group, yes, just tomorrow, one day, just give me one day. Saturday I'll just prepare the WhatsApp group. On Saturday the WhatsApp group would also be there. So I think if all the students are agreeing to this, I think let's stick with that then. It is in fact a good suggestion considering the fact that we are now in September. Fine, so therefore you are doing your self-study, so your time is not like, you are not feeling like, okay, enough of time is going, isn't it? So it is an approved particular thing. So it is approved, not, it is not unrecognized, it is recognized by all of you, isn't it? So 9 to 10:30 10:45 tops, okay, we will do our revision so that there is, without pressure also we can do consistent revision. While you are having dinner also, you can just keep on doing the revision. Okay, you can keep your this thing 9 o'clock, that time, and have your dinner around that time, and so that you are doing real time basis, saving time also, and that is the best particular way to take it forward. Okay, so I'll start tomorrow at 9 o'clock, and that's all. 9 to 10:30 10:45 we are going to stretch it up. Now friends, 43B is the last point which I'm going to do, 43B, and then I'm going to switch to some practical problems. Now what is this 43B, students? No, from tomorrow we'll start at 9 o'clock. So 43B, students, 43B, what exactly it is? As now we have seen all the items, all the items, students, we have seen tax, duty, cess or fee, all the indirect tax. So if it is linked in 43B, if it is written in 43B, what does it imply? You have to revise like this. It will imply that the deduction of the specified amount will be allowed only on actual payment, will be allowed only on actual payment. And point number two, students, point number two would be that these particular payment, students, these particular payments should be made. When the payment should be made? So these particular payments should be made, if not in the same year, at least on or before the due date of filing of the ROI, to get the deduction, to get the deduction in the same previous year, to get the deduction in the same previous year. And if you miss the due date of filing of the ROI and you make the payment later on, after the due date of filing of the ROI, then in the year in which the payment is made, in the year in which the payment is made, in that very year the deduction would be allowed. In the year in which the payment is made, in that very year the deduction would be allowed. So first year only, students, just be careful, only in the first year you have that grace period of making the payment on or before the due date of filing of the ROI, only for that first year period. So keep that particular point. Thereafter, If you don't have made the payment, you make the payment later on, so that later year you will get the deduction. So all these things which I've covered, tax I've covered, employer contribution I've covered, bonus and commission I've covered, interest part I've covered. Here there is one important point, students, one very important point that I'll discuss now. The same thing, point number E also, interest part, same thing. Okay, so from the loan from the banks and all, they are being covered over here in this particular context. Then this is the leave encashment, students. Point number F, sum payable by the employer in lieu of any leave to the credit of his employee. So this is your leave encashment. Remember a leave encashment salary that you pay. So even that leave encashment salary, students, even if the leave encashment salary, students, which is the given, in that case the deduction would be allowed. The leave encashment, students, that deduction would be allowed. So that is how it would be considered. Point number G. Now, students, herein pay sum payable to Indian Railways for use of railway asset. Now you remember, now there are many of the railways assets are like train is taken on hire for the transportation of their goods. So only when you make the payment to Indian Railway, only when you make the payment to the Indian Railway for the use of, say, their train facilities for the transportation of their goods, so that time only the deduction will be allowed. And last one is about the interest on the loans and advances from a scheduled bank. Interest on any loans and advances from a scheduled bank, accordingly the same treatment would be given. Now, students, here there is one point which I wanted to discuss with all of you. Just pay attention. And one point, students, over here is, sometimes what happens, please pay attention, sometimes what happens is that the borrower, I have taken the borrowings, okay, I'm not in a position to make the payment to the bank. So what the bank does, do you know what the bank does? Bank then makes some sort of a rehabilitation program. Now you say, sir, what is this rehabilitation program? As per these rehabilitation program, students, the bank will make a kind of a package. As per that particular package, what the bank will do? The bank will say that this outstanding interest, I will make this as your principal. Students, outstanding interest, whatever is the outstanding interest which I am not in a position to make the payment to the bank makes that outstanding interest as my principal portion. The bank make that outstanding interest as what? As the principal portion. And thereafter what? That principal portion is what is been paid. The principal portion is what has been paid. So that principal portion which is paid by the bank later on, maybe in parts, doesn't matter, but that particular principal portion which earlier was an interest. So please understand one thing. One time they have asked a question in your IPCC earlier, which was, if the bank has converted the interest amount into principal portion, if the bank has converted the interest amount, outstanding interest amount, as your principal portion, will this conversion be considered as payment of the interest amount? What is your take, students? Will this conversion be considered as the payment of the interest amount? Will it be considered as a payment? Shall I consider this to be a payment now? What is your take, friends? Shall I consider this as a payment? And the answer, students, just a conversion if I have done of the outstanding interest amount into a principal portion, merely a conversion, students, is not equal to payment. Merely a conversion is not equal to payment. So please don't give any deduction to the borrower. I was the borrower. So merely on the conversion. So there was an outstanding interest which I am yet to pay. So the bank, what it did, they said that your outstanding interest, we will convert into a principal amount. We shall convert into a principal amount. So question therefore is whether the conversion of the outstanding interest into a principal amount, will this be considered as a payment of the principal amount? Answer is no. And the answer is no. The conversion is not equal to payment. The conversion of outstanding interest into a principal amount is not equal to payment, and hence no deduction will be given. But if, please pay attention, students, but if subsequently that principal amount is repaid, if subsequently that principal amount, students, is repaid, now can I say that this subsequent repayment of the principal amount, can that be considered as subsequent repayment of the principal amount? Can that now be considered as the payment of the interest amount? Can that be now considered the principal amount which I am paying now, which in one time it was an outstanding interest. So when today I am paying that principal amount, so now can I say I am making the payment of an interest? Can I now claim a deduction of that interest amount, which is actually a principal, which is now converted into principal? Can I now claim a deduction, students? And the answer is yes. So in although in the form, today when I am making the payment, in form it is named as payment towards principal. But in substance, we all know it is a payment of a interest amount. So in substance, we all know it is nothing but a payment of a principal amount. And therefore what, students? Therefore, it will be allowed as deduction. Did you all got this one, students? So just keep this particular point in mind, that just like this, that converge, just write, please write it, students, there itself or somewhere, just write. I'll just dictate one line. Conversion of the outstanding interest into a principal loan amount shall be considered shall not just write please write like this shall not be considered shall not be considered as a payment of interest and therefore no deduction in respect of such payment will be allowed Next line, students. However, subsequently, when the converted portion of the principal amount is paid, then then such payment, will be treated as, the payment towards, the interest amount and hence the assessee shall be allowed the deduction in the year in which the outstanding interest amount has been paid in the form of principal amount, Why I'm saying in the form of principal amount? Because presently it is in the form of the principal amount. Isn't it? So that is the reason why in the form of the principal amount. Fine, students? Fair enough. So this is one thing that you will keep in mind herein. Now, apart from that, students, there are like 40AI and all disallowance, and there is one more, 40B, which is in respect of partnership form. These two, and the third one is a presumptive section. So these three, I will try to postpone it for the subsequent session, and we will now come to the practical part of the question, students. Let's see the practical part of the question. Herein, all of you question number 17, this is what I was suggesting herein. So see, they have given a question to all of you. Question number 17, which is in page number 287. What it says? Hari, an individual, carried on the business of purchase and sale of agricultural commodities like paddy, wheat, etc. He borrowed loan from Andhra Pradesh State Financial Corporation and Indian Bank, and has not paid interest as detailed thereunder. I'll tell you, Priyanka, later towards the end now. And has not paid interest as detailed here under. Andhra Pradesh State Financial Corporation, previous year 1819 and 1920. So that is the interest part. Indian Bank, previous year 1920. So Andhra Pradesh, this State Financial Corporation, 2 years. Indian Bank, 1 year. 15 lakhs and 30 lakhs each, or respectively. So if you go herein carefully, both APSFSC and Indian Bank, while restructuring the loan facilities of Hari during the year 1920, converted the above interest payable, by Hari to them as a loan repayable in 60 equal installment, students. So 60 equal installments. During the year ended 31st March 2020, Hari paid 5 installments to APFSC and 3 installments to Indian Bank. Hari claimed the entire interest of 45 lakhs as an expenditure while computing the income from the head PGBP. Okay, so first of all, we all know that what he has done, just because in the year 1920, that the conversion has taken place, he has taken the deduction. I just now gave you the note, and the note was what? No deduction would be allowed in respect of the outstanding interest which has been converted. So just forget it. No deduction, students. And subsequently, when that outstanding interest amount has been paid as a principal amount, so how much you have paid? So they have given to you during the year 31st March, by 31st March 2020, Hari paid 5 installment. So this is divided by 60 into 5. And this is also divided by 60 into 3. And the next one is divided by 60 into 3. So this would be the total amount that they have paid in the name of principal. But is it in substance a interest amount? And the answer is yes. In substance, whatever that pro rata payment of 5 and 3 has been done in the current period is in substance a payment towards the interest amount, and hence, students, it will be allowed as deduction. So how much would be allowed as deduction? 2,75,000. How you got this? For 5, if you do that, divide by 60 into 5, and for that 30 lakhs, divide by 60 into 3, you will get these amounts. Fine. So keep this particular perspective in mind, students, over here in this context. Now then, the other question. So just tick mark those questions which I am doing with you herein. So therefore, you just be very careful. This presumptive income, I am going to touch upon in the subsequent lecture. So any questions based on the presumptive income also, I'll do it in the subsequent class. Now I come to your last category, which is so this is for depreciation. Please do this as your homework question. Ensure to do this. Mr. Venus engaged in manufacture of pesticide. This is your depreciation question, actual cost. So this will be a good practice for all of you. Even the second question is a depreciation question. 1 and 2 is all about depreciation. Good practice. Those who want to have a practice on depreciation further, 1 and 2 is all about the depreciation. Coming to question number 3. Let's deal with this. So 1 and 2, I am putting that as a homework. Question number 1 and question number 2. Okay, for depreciation part, just ensure to go through this. Let's come to question 3. Examine with reason the allowability of the following expenses incurred by Mr. Manav, a wholesale dealer of commodities, under the Income Tax Act 1961, while computing profit and gains from business or profession for the assessment year 2021. Construction of school building in compliance with the CSR activities. Student, CSR. Just now we were discussing something about CSR. Will the expenditure, which is essentially in the nature of that CSR activity, will that be allowed to you as a deduction? Say, And the answer is no, it will not be allowed as deduction. Just now you have seen in 37.1. The issue also we have discussed, isn't it? So definitely, as you are saying it correctly, it will be disallowed. Coming to point number 2, purchase of building for the purpose of specified business, of setting up and operating a warehousing facility for storage of food grains amounting to rupees 4.5 lakhs. So students, this 4.5 lakhs, 35 AD, remember the 35 AD? In point number 2. So will it be covered in section 35 AD? And the answer is yes. Nishank is asking, sir, what is the difference between not allowed and disallowed? Not allowed means, technically speaking, it is not debited in your net profit. It is not debited to your net profit as per your accounting books. So if it is not debited and that expenditure is also not allowed as deduction under the head PGBP, so we will say it is not allowed. But something which is debited, but it is disallowed. What is the reason why it is disallowed? Say for example, bonus and commission. It is debited in your profit and loss account. Bonus and commission, if it is debited to your profit and loss account. Okay, but you have not made the actual payment at all. You have not made the actual payment at all. So therefore, as per 43B, what is that we are going to say? We are going to say that this bonus and commission will be disallowed. This bonus and commission will be disallowed. So that is what we are going to refer for bonus and commission to be disallowed. Coming to point number 3, Shrunth. Interest on loan paid to Mr. X, a resident, ₹50,000, on which tax has not been deducted. Not been deducted, Shrunth. TDS has not been deducted. So interest on loan paid to Mr. X, this is 40AIA. 40AIA. Interest on loan paid to Mr. X, ₹50,000, on which tax has not been deducted. The sales for the previous year 18-19 was ₹202 lakhs. Mr. X has not paid the tax, if any, on such interest. So what will happen, students, would be that this much of the amount of the interest on which TDS has not been deducted, we will see subsequently that this will be disallowed. Commodity transaction tax. Commodity transaction tax. Just now we have seen, isn't it? Security transaction tax, commodity transaction tax, banking cash transaction tax. Is this allowed as deduction? And the answer is yes. And the answer is yes. So students, herein, this interest part, friends, any case, this 30% disallowed, 40AIA, this point number 3, 40AIA, 30% is disallowed. So friends, this is how we have done. As I told you, friends, you don't have to remember the clause numbers and all. Just 36.1 will be sufficient. 36.1 will be sufficient enough. You don't have to by heart all these clause numbers. Fine. Coming to question number 4, friends. Question number 4. Let's quickly run through to the question number 4. Let's come to question number 4. Examine with reason the following subdivision, whether the following statements are true or false, having regard to the provision of the Income Tax Act 1961. For a dealer in shares and securities, securities transaction tax paid in a recognized stock exchange is permissible business expenditure. Is permissible business expenditure. We have just now seen security transaction tax. Is it allowed as deduction under the PGBP? And the answer is yes. So it is allowed. It is specifically, you will write in the reason, it is specifically allowed as a deduction under section 36.1. That is the reason. It is specifically allowed as deduction under section 36. Even though you just make a reference of 36, after 36, whatever is there, forget it. It is allowed as deduction under section 36. Even that will serve the purpose. Point 2. Where a person follows mercantile system of accounting, an expenditure of ₹25,000 has been allowed on accrual basis, and in a later year, students, in a later year, in respect of the said expenditure, assessee makes the payment of ₹25,000 through a check crossed as and company ₹25,000 can be the profit and gains of business. The question itself is not properly framed. Where a person follows mercantile system of accounting, an expenditure of ₹25,000 has been allowed on accrual basis, and in a later year, in respect of the said expenditure, SSE makes a payment of ₹25,000 through a check crossed as and company ₹25,000 can be the profit and the gains, can be the profit and gains in the year of payment. Can be the profit and gains. So there is something missing, words are missing. this is not, this part is something which has to be clarified. What they are trying to see can be the profit and gains. I'm not in a position to connect it properly. Anyway, true, whatever the concept that we have learned right now, just focus only on that. Okay, so the question is not properly framed. Something is missing in between. Can be the profit and gains, what does it mean? Coming to point number three, but anyway, this is just on the basis of whatever we have done just now. It is in the subsequent year. So if it is a subsequent year, 40A3A will come into play. Point number three, it is mandatory to provide for depreciation under section 32. Yes, students, mandatory. Yes, it is mandatory. Depreciation allowance under 32 is mandatory. Students, depreciation allowance under section 32 is mandatory. There is one specific section, but as I told you, you don't remember the section number. Just, it is mandatory. Yes, it is mandatory. Point number four, the medical premium paid to GIC, the medical premium paid to GIC by Mr. Lomesh for his employee by a draft on 27 December 2019 is deductible expenditure. Yes, it is deductible. Only point just now we did. Only point is that it should not be paid in cash, other than cash. So yes, it is allowed. Point number five, under section 35 DDA, amortization of expenditure incurred under the eligible VRS at the time of retirement alone can be done only when he retires. There is no such question at all. Only when he retires. Primary. Under 35 DDA, it is allowed as deduction. Primary. In this regard, in the year in which it is paid. So yes, in the year in which it is paid plus 5 years, the allowance would be for 5 years period. So that is one thing which would be there in this regard. So what you will say, under 35 DDA, amortization of expenditure incurred under the eligible VRS at the time of retirement alone can be done. Retirement alone is not there. Payment. Making payment, incurred in making payment to the employees. You are retired. Students, you are retired, but you have not been paid. Whether amortization, can it be done? No. So therefore, the payment is the criteria. Only when it has been paid, primary, that the amortization will begin. Amortization in 5 equal annual installment. Point number 6. Students, be one thing I should tell you. Whenever these extreme words are used in the question, this is just through my experience I am telling you. Whenever these extreme words, like alone, only because of this, that this is there. Only because of this, that this is there, like that. Or alone, that is what they have used over here. Whenever they make this extreme observation on a particular point, 90%, or I will say 95%, the answer is incorrect. The answer would be false. The statement is false. Primarily, the statement that they are making is false. 90 to 95%. This is just my observation. I'm telling you. Whenever they make this, these extreme observation. What is that extreme observation? That only because of this, that this is happening. So generally, that statement is incorrect, and that is one thing which I can just let you know through the some experience kind of a thing. Point number 6, an existing SSC engaged in trading activity can claim additional depreciation. Is additional depreciation available for a person who is in the trading activity? Is the additional depreciation applicable to a person who is in the trading activity is the question. And the answer has to be false. And the answer has to be false. Yes, students, coming to question number 5 now. Let's come to question 5. Examine with reasons the allowability of the following expenses under the Income Tax Act while computing income from business or profession for the assessment year 2021. Provision made on the basis of actuarial valuation for payment of gratuity. Students, whether the gratuity, is it allowed on the basis of the provision? Whether the gratuity, is it allowed on the basis of the provision? And the answer is no. We have seen there's a disallowance under 40A7. there is a disallowance under 40A7. Moreover, this gratuity is covered in 43B. And as per 43B, the deduction is allowed only in the year in which the payment has been done. And that exactly how it has to be considered, students. So point number one, provision made on the basis of the actual violation for payment of the gratuity 5 lakhs. So not allowed, provision disallowed. Point number two, purchase of oil seed, students. Purchase of oil seeds of rupees 50,000 in cash from a farmer on a banking day. So, from whom? From a farmer. So, can we say it is covered in Rule 6DD? Students, is it covered in Rule 6DD from a farmer? Is it an agriculture produce? Oil seeds? Agriculture produce oil seeds? And the answer is yes. It is an agriculture produce, and you are making the payment to the farmer directly. Just now we have read in Rule 6DD, payment to the farmer or the producer or the cultivator or the grower of the agricultural produce, that is covered in Rule 6DD, meaning thereby that amount will be allowed as deduction, the expenditure will be allowed as deduction. Payment of rupees 50, point number three, students, we have not touched upon, but this you can just see in 40A. When you read 40A, I think double two or double three, I have made an observation over this. Tax on non-monetary perquisite will be allowed as deduction. You will just read it at your end, this part. Point number three, students, you can read it at your end. I'll come to point number four. Payment of rupees 50,000. By using credit card for fire insurance. Obviously, so it is in prescribed electronic mode. Is it a prescribed electronic mode? And the answer is yes. So if it is a prescribed electronic mode, therefore, will it be allowed to you as a deduction? Point number four. And the answer is yes. This is a prescribed electronic mode, and accordingly, it shall be allowed to you as a deduction. After that, point number five. Banking day or non-banking day doesn't matter, but it is paid to whom? In cash, but it is paid to whom? To the farmer. That is only relevant. Paid to farmer, that is only relevant. Point number five. Salary payment of rupees 4 lakhs to Mr. X outside India by a company without deduction. So this is also students. These are things which I have not touched upon right now. So since I have not touched upon right now, if you have done it, you would have known the answer. These are all about 40AI and all. That 40AI series. So that is in 40AI series, students. That is covered over there. So I think if those who have done it, they would have answered it. Otherwise, wait for tomorrow. Point number six. Payment made in cash. Rupees for 30,000 to a transporter in a day for carriage of goods. If they would have said carriage of passenger then. What would have happened? Would you still have allowed the deduction? And the answer is no. For carriage of passenger, then you would have taken the threshold of 10,000, not 35,000. For carriage of passenger, like Ola company, Uber company and all. So, if supposedly you have hired these company or some any passenger transport companies for transportation of your employees to the other locations. So, for them, the threshold would be rupees 10,000. And not 35,000. That is the threshold. The threshold of rupees 35,000 is applicable only in respect of the which company? The company which is, these are the companies that we are talking about it. The companies which are in the business of the carriage of goods and all. Question number 6, students. examine with reason whether the following statements are true or false with regard to the provision of the Income Tax Act 1961. Payment made in respect of a business expenditure incurred on the 16th February 2020 for ₹25,000 through a check duly crossed as and company is hit by the provision of 40A3. Yes, it is hit by the provision of 40A3 because you have to write account payee check. Account payee. Okay. Only a cross check will not be sufficient. You have to write what? Account payee. You have to write what, students? Account payee. Okay. So, therefore, it will be disallowed. Point number B. Point 1 of point B. It is a condition precedent to write off in the books of accounts the amount due from the debtors to claim the deduction for bad debt. Just now I taught you, students. Just now I have taught you this point. There are two conditions for the purpose of deduction of bad debts. And which are those two conditions? Condition number one, the amount should have been considered as the income of the SSE earlier. The amount should be considered as the income of the SSE earlier. That is first. That's the reason why sales to debtors account. Sorry, debtors to sales account. And second one is what? Second one is that the debtors account is written off as a bad debt. The debtors account is written off as a bad debt in your books of accounts. In your books of accounts. So whether the write-off is it a condition for the purpose of claiming of the deduction of bad debt? And the answer is yes. Point number two. Now, this point number two again is of TDS, but still let's see. Failure to deduct TDS at source in accordance with the provision. Failure to deduct the TDS at source in accordance with the provision of Chapter 17B inter alia from the amount payable to a non-resident. Students, to a non-resident means who is the receiver, who is the payee, who is the payee or who is the receiver? It is a non-resident. So, I have not deducted the TDS. I have not deducted a TDS. Will it result into disallowances while computing the business income? Will it result? And the answer is yes, it will be disallowed. And with section 40AI. Yes, it will be disallowed under section 40AI. Fine, students. So, students, this is what we have done it here in up till now. For your homework, students, question number 1 and question number 2 is what you can do. Of this solved question, which is in respect of depreciation. Tomorrow I'll just do some of the disallowances part of it, and also presumptive income I'll see, so that I can also solve tomorrow some more question. And mostly students, then Saturday we'll start with capital gains. Fine, students. So I'll see you then tomorrow. You revise question number 1 and question number 2. Do it, and I'll see you tomorrow then. 9 o'clock would be the timing. That time we'll meet tomorrow at 9 p.m. and then we will try to finish it off the remaining part. Three rounds. I think even Ravi sir is not keeping well herein. So he, in fact, there is unfortunately in his family. Somebody expired because of COVID. So, and that came just 4 days back. So, because of this COVID, his uncle has expired. And that is the reason why I think then all the rituals has to be done. So, according to these people would be not, so he is not in a available one and also not in the proper this thing. So, that is the part for the this one. Auditing part, which I just came to know, and that is one thing which I can just communicate with all of you. And other subjects, as it has been there, I think law will start with Purnavas sir is going to start on 10th, I suppose. So his timing, I think, is in the evening. And then Tharun Raj sir is also due for his IDT part. So I think all these are as scheduled. So this is one thing which has been there. Ashwini, is income from house property that is done? No, not yet. I have started directly. I have done in my initial lectures the basic concept, scope of total income, residential status, and the exempt income. These are the topic which I have done in my initial lectures. So these are the topic which I have done in my initial lectures. Okay, the scope of the total income, residential status, exemption. These are the income. These are the topic which I have done in the initial lecture, and directly we have started with PGBP. Then we will do capital gains because these are the two big heads. Students, see, these are the two big heads. After that, small heads are there. We can finish it off fast. Quick revision can be done. But the fact is that the big topics, if we do it thoroughly initially, so then the pressure is very less later on. The small house property and all, we can all discuss quickly and do some areas of tricky areas, couple of questions, we can finish it off, move on. That space that we can maintain, isn't it? So that is one thing which has been there. So let's take the bigger part earlier. Earlier the better. So therefore Saturday I'll start with capital gains. Okay. See you then, students. Good night to all of you, and I'll see you tomorrow night at 9 p.m. Thank you.